What's up? Wow. Oh, wow. What's up? It is good to see all of you. Amen. There's been many people talk to me and Scotty and some others about the explosion that's going to happen when... Stay there. I don't need this. It's gonna blow my pages everywhere. But man, there's been a lot of people talk about a vision of the church exploding when we get kicked out of the boat and we start walking on the water and we get in the tent and we start just preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and the love of Jesus Christ and the truth of Jesus Christ. And it's already starting. So you're going to have to act like you love each other a little bit better and get closer. Let me tell you, I was back there during worship and I was literally almost sobbing. People were coming in. I'm like, how are you? Sorry, come on in. You know, like, Britt, you're going to have to help them find a seat. And we're setting seats out. Man, the Holy Spirit is here today. And Caitlin is speaking a lot of truth today with what she said. You know, today is a very special day for a lot of people in here. As after this, we will go and have a baptism where they publicly confess to every single person ever that they are a Christian, that they are following Jesus Christ, that the old man is gone, and what comes up is the new, and they are forever changed. And today is a very special day, and it's a very good day. I got to start out by some people in here need to know this. I think I'm going to get to the message God had me prepare, but I've got to start here in Romans 5:8, if you want to turn there. Romans 5:8. So I'm really excited. God just kept speaking this verse to me back there while I'm crying, trying to keep it together, worshiping. You know, how many of you are good singers? A few. See, I'm not a good singer. And I don't know if they heard me over. I'm not a good singer. And when I get emotional, I get a lot worse. How many of y'all are there with me? Y'all get a lot, man, when it's there's keys, cues. I don't even know what's coming out. You know what I'm saying? It's bad. But Romans 5:8 says, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Let's dig down into that a little bit. Every single one of us has fallen short of the glory of God. In fact, even in our Christian walks, we fall short of the glory of God. Daily. Sometimes minute by minute. And if you're like me, it compounds. If I do something bad, it just keeps on happening until I make the decision to trust in God and to stop it from happening. But it's so amazing to me that God showed his great love for you. Do you understand where you once were? Do you understand the situation, the circumstances that you were once in? Yes. I was in a bad place. I was good, though, at playing it. Why? Because I knew exactly what to say. But on the inside, I was as dirty as anybody else. Yes. And while I was living in that sin, God sent Christ to earth to die for me and to take those sins away from me when I chose him, that I would literally be freed from the tyranny that sin had on my life.
That's right.
How amazing. How much love it does that show that God loves you that much? How much love that he said, you know what, son?
I'm going to send you to earth. And you know what? You're going to have to die. And guess what? It's not going to be fun. And guess what? It's going to hurt really bad. You're going to shed a lot of blood. And it's going to hurt and it's not going to be fun. But guess what? But guess what? He sent him for you and your sin. And he sent him to earth while you were still in the state that you were in. For a simple 50-50 shot that you would choose him.
That's right. Wasn't it for sure thing? That's exactly right.
I don't know about y'all, but 50-50, 50% chance it's going right, 50% chance it ain't. You know, I don't know. You know? But literally, the beautiful thing about it was he sent him to earth to die for you, and then guess what he did? He completely took it out of his hands and put it in yours. And he said, you have the choice to accept it, to accept the eternal sacrifice or not. To accept the eternal sacrifice and find the freedom that I'm trying to give you, or live in the damnation that you have chosen and go to hell with it. Wow. What love. What love Jesus Christ has for us, that he laid on the cross willingly, and it was a 50-50 shot. You know, I think something that we have to understand here at TCAB, and some of you visitors, it's good to see everybody, but something that we have to understand is that we are building a building, and that is part of our vision, but that is not the only vision. Okay? That is not the only vision. And it is going to be very, very important for everyone in here to not have an agenda. And it's going to be very, very important for us to not lose our focus, not shift our focus from kingdom. We started this church on being kingdom-minded. What does that mean? That means we're going to grow from babies to maturity in this place. Okay? It's going to be very important for you to not shift your focus from being kingdom-minded. When we are kingdom-minded, we understand that some people are going to come in here and they're going to receive Jesus and then they're going to leave. We understand by being kingdom-minded that we're going to get people in here that are supposed to be leaders. And guess what? If you're called to be a leader, we're about to start growing you up to be that leader. So you better get ready. There's going to be some mentorship taking place. There's going to be discipleship taking place. Being kingdom-minded is simply not caring where you go to church, but hopefully being able to touch you in a way that you go to church and you find Jesus. We cannot lose our simple focus that we started on with kingdom. Sometimes it's so hard for us because we start seeing the vision of God and we see the explosion that God has taking place, and then the enemy tries to shift in our minds that we're trying to build a church here. I'm not trying to build a church. I'm trying to build a kingdom for Jesus Christ. Amen. And some of it's going to be here and some of it's not. Some of it's going to be here in this place and some of it's going to be out in the community, just showing people the love of Jesus Christ, that he came and died for you even while you were in the state you were in. You know, all of you sitting in here are not supposed to just come in here and sit and then leave and go about your life the way you were going about it. Your job is to impact people around you in your life. Some of you in here are doing a great job at that. Okay, so God's not speaking to you. But some of us need to get out of the boat, man. Some of us need to reevaluate our heart and our mindset, because I feel like some of us in here are serving in areas and we think serving is good. We think serving is our Christian walk. You know what I'm saying? Okay, I'll give you a little example, okay? And this is not an example of anybody up here. But if I'm a singer in the worship team and I can sing like a songbird, that's not me, okay? But if I can sing, but I see me just singing up here as my Christian walk, and I go home and act a fool, and I go home and waller in my sin, this is not your Christian walk. You know what I'm saying? Like, some of us, the enemy tries to get in our minds that these different things are part of are your Christian walk. When let's just get to the basics here today. You can go to any church you want to go to, but if you don't have a true blue relationship with Jesus Christ, then He doesn't know you.
That's exactly right. That's Bible, buddy. That's Bible.
You can go anywhere. You can go here. You can go down the road. You can go anywhere you want to go. But if you personally don't have a relationship with Jesus, now you might be asking me, Jordan, what is a relationship? A relationship is an interactive relationship with Jesus Christ. How many of you are married? So a lot of you are married. But if you're not married, at least you got friends, right? And let me ask you, if you don't talk to those friends, if you don't learn more about those friends, how deep does that friendship go? Surface level. Who said that? Hey, ding, 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 ding. There you go. Everybody give Kylie a round of applause. Good job, Kylie. It's surface level. God wants you to dig deeper. He doesn't want you to stay at surface level. Why does He not want you to stay at surface level? Because if you stay at surface level, you're not going to obtain the purpose that He has for your life. Why? Because you're never going to know it. Why? Because you're surface level. If I have a relationship with a friend, right? And golly, why is this? You know what? I'm going to pick up a mic. I don't know why this is getting on my nerves today. Thank you. I feel much better now. Where was I at? Surface level, friendship. So here's the deal. If let's say I'm in a friendship with Caitlin, okay? You're just the first one I saw, okay? And let's say that me and her are friends and me and her don't ever talk unless I need something. Right? We don't ever talk unless I need something. Caitlin, listen, can you come over here and put this light fixture up because I really don't know how to do it. You know what I'm saying? Can you come? And she has a great heart. Sure, I'll come do that. Even if she's not an electrician, hey, she's going to try to do it. You know what I'm saying? But if that's the only time we interact is when I need something, how deep is that relationship going to be? And then guess what's eventually going to happen? When I call her, she knows all he needs is something. So am I answering the phone? No, I'm not answering the phone. Why? Because I don't want to do it. See, so many of us use Jesus Christ as our doctor, as our lawyer, and as somebody who, you know, Lord, I need some money because I got to pay this bill that I accumulated myself because I didn't listen to what you wanted me to do. And I bought this thing and I shouldn't have. But, you know, God, I really need so many times that's as deep as our relationship with Jesus Christ goes. I'm going to kind of shift gears here. So, first thing is that we can't lose our focus from being kingdom-minded, all right? We cannot lose our focus from being kingdom-minded. So I feel like God wants me to talk about this, so let's go here. Matthew 6. All right, so I want to share a little bit of vision with you, okay? So, yes, our current vision is building the building, but guess what? It goes deeper than that. Okay, there's another vision beyond that vision that I don't think you've been told yet, and I'm going to tell you today.
Okay? So that vision is to bring heaven to earth. To bring little bits of heaven to earth. Okay? And you're like, Jordan, I don't know where you're going with this. Let's check it out. Matthew. Jesus is showing, Matthew 6, Jesus is showing his disciples how to pray. Okay? So right here, let's just start in verse 5. When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on the street corners and in synagogues where everyone can see them. What was that about, that service thing? That's our walk. Service is a fruit of your walk, not your walk. Okay? All right, so let's keep going here. It says, I tell you the truth, that is all the reward they will ever get. They're not stacking up treasures in heaven. That recognition they're getting right there, that's the only recognition they'll ever get. Why? Because they don't know me. Why? Because they're faking it. Okay? But when you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father in private. This is an intimate relationship. You see, ladies and gentlemen, if you don't have an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, then you're not going to have a public relationship with Him either. If I don't have a private relationship with my wife, then we're not going to be seen out in public together because we don't have one. Right? You see, so many of us are missing that private relationship with Jesus Christ. And we're trying to make the public relationship look like it's private. And it don't work. It doesn't work. Why? Because you can only ride that coattail. You can only fake it for so long. Until the fruits of that relationship show up. Oh, man. So then it says, then your Father who sees everything will reward you. He'll reward you. Not people. Not circumstance. Not people. Your Father will reward you. Check this out. It says, when you pray, don't babble on and on as people of other religions do. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. I'm going to say this. Some of us have got to be able to decipher the familiar spirit that is trying to overtake you. When you pray a prayer, it goes out to Jesus and it never goes away. Never. When you speak a word, the power of life and death is in your tongue, and you have power in that through Jesus Christ. And when you speak a word, it is out in the atmosphere forever in the spiritual realm. We don't have to act like we're spiritual to be spiritual. Because so many people confuse people because they look spiritual when on the inside they're really not. Be you who Jesus Christ led you to be. Be you. Don't be the next Billy Graham. I want to be Jordan Hunter. Don't be the next, you know, Hillsong. Be TCAB. You know what I'm saying? Don't be the next whoever you idolize or whoever you look forward to or look up to. Don't try to be the next them. Try to be the one and only you. You know why? Because you get one shot at this life. I hope you empty the clip. You get one shot at this thing. And I pray that you empty the clip. Right here it says, don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need before you even ask Him. Pray like this. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon.
May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this. Give us today the food we need, and forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. That's how Jesus told you how to pray. That's how Jesus told you how to pray. If Jesus told me to pray this way, I think that's good enough. So many of us are getting caught in this overly charismatic movement. Jesus taught me to pray like this. That's how I'm going to pray. But I want to touch on something. It says, bring heaven. And I just want to let you know, we are charismatic here. We do believe in the gifts. We do believe in healing. We do believe in miracles. Okay? I want to touch on verse 10. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus, when he was teaching the disciples how to pray, prayed to the Father and said, Father, whatever's going on up in heaven, whatever that is, make it come down here. Make it come down here. And guess what? The only way that the Father can make it come down here is through you, the servant. The hands and feet of Jesus Christ, the ones who recognize what they're supposed to do, they recognize their purpose, they recognize the will that God has in their life, and every single moment of the day, they are bringing a little bit of heaven down here to earth. A little bit, just a little bit. You know, and we talk a little bit and we're like, hey, you know, what does heaven look like? Heaven looks like no children being hungry. Every single child in heaven is fed and perfectly healthy and perfectly fine. No children are sick. There is no sickness in heaven. Bring a little bit of heaven to earth. No mental health issues. Praise God. You're going to be healed one day. Praise the Father. But what can you do to bring heaven to earth? No abuse. No women having to deal with their husbands beating on them. Vice versa. No husbands having to worry about women beating on them. Hey, look, hey, you know. No pain, no stress, no addiction. No addiction, because Jesus is enough in heaven. In heaven, there is peace, there is joy, there's satisfaction. I can't wait for this. There's worship. There's only good. Kindness, and the greatest love. And you might be saying, Jordan, that sounds great. I think you're overshooting it a little bit. It's your job to bring the goodness and love and kindness of heaven to earth. That's your job. That's my job. That's every believer's job, is to bring heaven to earth. Why? Because Jesus prayed it. And I believe when Jesus prayed it, he meant it. You see, many we have to come to the realization that our prayers are for us. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus shows us how to pray. And something we have to realize is that when we pray, it's personal. That was a personal prayer Jesus Christ prayed to his Father. When you pray a prayer to the Father, it is personal. Lord,
I prayed this morning for all you getting baptized. I said, Lord, don't you dare let the enemy have a foothold today. Because today is their day of glory, Father. The angels will rejoice again. They rejoiced when the salvation happened, but they're going to rejoice more, Father, when they make it public for every single one to know. And I prayed, and that, guys, that was personal. That was a personal pointed prayer. Father, protect them. Do not let the enemy have one foothold on them today. Bring them to church today, Father. Make sure, Father, that nothing happens in their life this morning to hinder them from what's going to happen on this beautiful, glorious day. It's personal. It's a personal talk between God and you, meaning it's personal for us to bring heaven to earth. If Jesus said it, I believe he meant it. If Jesus said it, I believe he meant it. Praise God. And you might be saying, Jordan, bring heaven to earth. Sounds great. How are you going to do it? How are you going to do it, Pastor? How are you going to lead us to do it? Well, it's hopefully as simple as what God gave it to me. It's your choice. It's your choice. But it looks like discipleship. That's what bringing heaven to earth looks like, is discipleship. And then something that we try really hard at here at TCAB is to insert life-changing ministries into your life to help you grow in that discipleship. Life-changing ministries. They both fit. Discipleship means love. Jesus, you know, the word Christian is spoken one or two times in the Bible depending on translation. Okay? Jesus didn't call you to be a Christian. He called you to be a disciple. Okay? And so we have to understand that discipleship is personal for us. If I call myself a Christian, I should be discipling someone. I should be talking to people daily about my Jesus. When something happens to a coworker of mine, I shouldn't talk bad about the situation. I shouldn't give negative thoughts about the situation. I should speak Jesus into that situation. Because Jesus is the only one going to change anything. He was the one before time. He's the one now. He's going to be the one after. He's going to be the only thing standing. Jesus. Speak the name Jesus over your home, over your children, over your life, and watch what happens to your life. The enemy might attack, but guess what? Jesus has more power than the enemy. Why? Because Jesus has already won. It's over. It's finished. Jesus has already won. He's already won the war. He's already won all the battles. It's over. All the enemy can do is try to make you think that it's not over and try to bring up stuff from your past to try to tell you lies. I also prayed, God, I know that the enemy's going to try to bring up lies this morning. May they not believe him this morning in Jesus' name. May they not believe him. Discipleship. Discipleship is sharing Jesus, teaching Jesus, loving Jesus, loving others to Jesus, and being Christ-like while doing life with people. That looks like meal drives. I want to give you some actual applicable stuff today. That looks like meal drives. Loving others. That looks like collecting crayons for the Ralph Bunch community. That looks like collecting diapers for a new mom. That looks like throwing a baby shower and showing up
to the baby shower to give the gifts. You see, some of you claim that you love, but your actions don't prove it. Didn't like that, sorry. It looks like storm cleanup when somebody needs a hand. It looks like helping people with their vehicles. If you're mechanically minded, my dad is a great mechanic. I did not get it. It like went to my brother and then it went right past me. And I was thinking the other day, I was like, God, like, all my son gonna know how to do is, I guess, go to Napa or somewhere. I don't know, you know what I'm saying? whenever my lawnmower breaks down, Dad, I don't know what's wrong with it. Well, try this. And then it works. I'm like, how did you know that? Anyway, but for real, like, it's amazing how that kind of passed me. But literally just being there for someone, counseling someone, cutting wood for someone, just sitting and listening to someone who's going through a difficult time, giving someone money that's going through a difficult time. Yesterday, we went to Texas Roadhouse, and me and Tara and the kids and my mom and dad, and there's a girl there that works there that I had in class, and she came up to me, and she just graduated high school, and she told me that she was expecting a child. And I said, really? And she said, yeah. And it looked like she was kind of ashamed about it. And I said, you've got this. I said, you're going to do it. And she said, yeah, I was kind of nervous at first, but I decided I got to do it. And I said, you're going to do it. And she walked off, and God just put on my heart, give her your number and tell her if she needs anything to call you. And so she came back by, and I said, hey, come here. And she said, yeah. And I said, hey, do you have my number? And she said, no. And I said, I'm going to give you Tara's number. And I said, if you need anything, and I mean anything, you call us and let us know. And you could just see her face kind of lit up. Really? That means a lot to me. It's the simple stuff, guys, that is discipleship. It's the simple showing Jesus Christ to your neighbor and loving your neighbor as yourself. That is the simple part of discipleship. We try to make this so difficult and so hard, and it's not. It's loving people. It's going out of your way to love someone today. It's going out of your way to just say, call me if you need me. You never know how much that statement means to somebody. That's discipleship. That's discipleship. That's loving people. I'm going to give you a couple examples. You know, a few years ago, Star City was hit with a tornado. And we got together and loaded up in our redneck selves and, went down there. And we partnered with the church, and me and Austin cooked hot dogs and hamburgers all day. I was like, oh, my gosh, I don't know how many more hamburgers I can cook. We had two crews the women stayed and helped us because we're not as redneck or whatever you want to say, right? I mean, we're good cooks, so we'll just say that. So then a couple of other crews got together, and they went out and cut wood up for people, got trees off their house. That is discipleship. That is loving one another, sharing the love of Jesus, and loving Jesus. Because guess what? You know how hard it is to go do something good for somebody if you don't have Jesus in your heart? Discipleship, it's funny that she's here today. But God led me to talk about women equipped today. Women equipped is discipleship. You know, Miss Everett got the vision to help women in our community that were struggling. Puts up her own money, gets donations from all of these places, and fixes up a place downtown for women to go and for them to be nurtured and for them to learn, and then disciple them and put them back out into the world to disciple others and be successful members of the Benton community. That is discipleship. That's also a life-changing ministry. Life-changing. Those women don't leave the same as they came, praise God, because they get Jesus, and Jesus changes everything. Man, it's so amazing. Yesterday, we were on a podcast with one of my good friends. I got ordained with him back in the Missionary Baptist Church. It's no longer valid, but we had a good time. We got ordained together. It was a beautiful day. We cried a lot. At the end of the day, though, like, we didn't have to be ordained. Jesus Christ ordained us. We didn't have to be ordained by men, but it is what it is, you know. Hey, at least I can marry you. It might not be valid, but it's in the Sling County book, so I can marry you. I can, what else can I do? I don't think I can do anything else with that, but it's okay. But yeah, you know, we got ordained together. We were on a podcast with him yesterday, and let me tell you, man, the Way Church in Gurdon, Arkansas, is bringing heaven to earth through discipleship. Let me tell you that. I mean, this is a small church, much like ours, about 150 people, like, and they are rocking it out, man. Somebody gave them a building and land, and they've started a drug rehab program, a three-month drug rehab program, life-changing ministry, discipling people. Life-changing ministry, discipling people. Bo said, we're about to bump it up another 3 months, so it's a six-month program here pretty soon. They didn't stop there. I don't know if they bought it or somebody gave them something else, but they're about to start a women's shelter for women that are struggling with drug addiction, women that are struggling, period, women that are in abusive relationships. They're going to be the place of safety for women and their kids. That is discipleship through life-changing ministries. Life-changing ministry is investing in ministry or in ministries that change the lives of the ones involved. Not doing something because we have to do it. Not doing it because we've always done it. Not doing it because it's tradition to do it. Not doing it because we're required to do it. It's ministry that is literally life-changing, and it doesn't matter how it looks. Life-changing ministry. You know, I was reading a book a while back, and it talked about life-changing ministry, and it totally, it stuck in my brain. Because how many times do we do ministry and it's not life-changing? How many times do we meet just because we're supposed to meet? And we leave and we got nothing out of it. Because it's not life-changing. You see, we at TCAB have got to do life-changing ministries in and through this place. Look, we're not going to build like a 14,000 square foot building over there to sit 5 days a week. I am the lead pastor. Scotty's senior pastor. I'm lead pastor. We kind of, you know, do it together. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Let me tell you, it's tough keeping him in line sometimes. Praise God. But I'm seeing leaders in this place. And I met with Trevor this week, and he just planted it in me. You got to do this. I'm like, yep, God, I got to do this. I see leaders, and you are about to be called out. You are about to be mentored. You're about to be discipled, and you are going to be the ones laying your life down as a sacrifice on the altar of Jesus Christ. You know what? You know what? When they sacrificed stuff back in the day, like back in the day, like maybe day, those sacrifices never got up from the altar. They laid down on that altar, and that's where they stayed. Some of you need to get on this altar and you don't ever need to move. You feel me? You need to be the living sacrifice God has called you to be. And guess what? Hey, we're going to get stuff going, what God's called you to do. I'm going to try to build you up through Jesus Christ, not nobody else, because you know I ain't very good at it. You know what I'm saying? And listen, you're going to be running ministries in and through this building that are going to be life-changing, discipling people so that when they leave, they are no longer the same. I'm glad leadership said yes and amen. But I need you to say it. Because you're the ones that are going to do it. This church is about 150 right now, 150 people. And I was talking to Scotty the other day. I said, I feel so bad. I tell everybody, I feel so bad. I don't know everybody in here. I don't. I'm sorry. I'm bad. I'm bad with names, for one. For two, when you walk in, I'm scared to be like, is this your first time here? Because you know how awkward that is? When you're like, hey, I'm Jordan, man. Is this your first time here? No, I've been here 4 times. All right, man, sorry. Glad you're here. That is so awkward. I don't know everybody. And guys, guess what? It's going to continue to go that way with the explosion of Jesus Christ. I'm not going to know everybody, but you know what? You're going to know your people. You're going to lead your people in life-changing ministries for Jesus Christ. And guess what? Youth might meet on Thursday. Youth might meet on Thursday. Kids might meet on Thursday. You might be leading a drug rehab on Tuesday. It is time. We, as a people, have got to become the church that God called us to be. We have got to be the staple in this community that is the heartbeat of this community. Do you hear me? We have to be the heartbeat. We've got to be the church that if we ever shut down, it would hurt this community. I'm not sure we're there yet. With our outreach and our service, I'm not sure we're there yet. But you know, our mission is to be a community for Christ, to bring the community around us to Christ. We have got to embrace that through discipleship, life-changing ministries. Life-changing ministries that go on in this place. Obviously, Chick Chat. Everybody I've heard from loved it. I understand that. I'm just surprised that either I've lost you, I've gone too long, because y'all ain't got much fire. Y'all ain't got as much fire as y'all had during the worship service. Women, was Chick Chat good? Thank you. Gosh, goodness gracious, I'm having to be a hype man now. Yeah, right. Counseling. How many of you know somebody that's going through a difficult time that you could call up right now and you could say, talk to me. It's not going to go anywhere. Talk to me. Because you know how good it feels when you're dealing with something to just get it off your chest and give it to a person that you know and trust, and they're not going to leave it? Guys, that is life-changing ministry. Why? Because it's changing their life. It doesn't have to change yours in the process. See, that's where we get so selfish with things. We think things need to change our life. How about let's be more like Jesus Christ, lay ourselves down on the altar, and make sure our life changes someone else's life. Man. I know my mom does, can I say it, CASA? My mom does CASA, where she stands in the gap for kids that are in the system. In court, she stands in the gap with them. She goes and meets with the kids at school and develops a relationship with them. Guys, that's discipleship. That's discipleship. That's life-changing ministry. It's not hard. It's not that hard. And we try to make it so difficult. life groups with true life-changing topics that are talked about, or life-changing ministries. We had one. I know we had one in the marriage. I know we did. Discipleship programs, which, get ready, because we're about to kick off a discipleship program. And you're going to either be invited to somebody's house or you're going to be the invitee, so you better get ready. I mean, just point blank period. I mean, Women Equipped is one that is serving our community as a life-changing ministry, discipling women. And you're like, Jordan, that is great, and you've talked a long time. I know, I'm sorry. But Jordan, that's great. You know, you're trying to hype me up, and I'm really not. You're really not doing a very good job of it. Let me speak some verses to you. Let's go to 2 Timothy 1:9. Let's actually start in 8. It says, never be ashamed to tell others about our Lord. Never be ashamed to tell others about your Jesus Christ. About your Jesus. Don't ever be ashamed to tell others about Jesus Christ. Why? Because I hope he changed your life. Do you feel me? He changed mine. I'm not the man I was 5 years ago. I'm not the man I was 10 years ago. I'm not the man I was 15 years ago. For one, I wasn't a man 15 years ago, but you know what I'm saying. But Jesus, Paul's talking to Timothy, he says, never be ashamed to tell anybody about Jesus Christ, man. Tell everybody. Reminds me of Jessie. She got saved last week. And, she came by the house to talk, and all she could say was, I'm saved. And I was like, let's do it. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's amazing. But it says in verse 9, it says, for God saved us, and he called us to live a holy life. He saved me, and he called me. It's not that he saved me, and now I'm chilling. It's not he saved me, and now I'm comfortable. It's he saved me, and he called me. I got a question. When you are hired when you're hired by an employer, what is next? Doing the job. Not everybody works for the county, Scotty. How you open that one up? But when you are hired to perform a job, the next step after signing the contract is doing the job. Guess what? If you don't do the job you were hired for, you're going to be looking for another one just like you were looking for that one. You know what I'm saying? When you are hired, there's then a job. Jesus goes the same way. He says, you were saved, and now you're called. He says, you were saved, and now you've got a job to do. You were saved, and now you have a purpose to live out. You were saved, and now my will for you is to do this. My ways are a lot higher and a lot crazier than yours, but listen, you've got a job to do now that you've been saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. You got a job to do. And guess what? Let's talk about that job. 1 Corinthians 12. So 1 Corinthians 12:12 says, the human body has many parts, but many parts make up the whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. Some are Jews, some are Gentiles, some are slaves, some are free. But we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit. One body, one Spirit. And we all share the same Spirit, which is the Spirit of the living God, which lives inside of you when you accept Jesus Christ into your heart. Mm. And then that power, that boldness, that's good. You know, the world tried to identify me as I can't remember what word God replaced it, because God has made me forget it. But God, when we went on the youth trip, the youth retreat, we wrote down words that the world had tried to call us and identify us as. And then we prayed to God and let Him replace those words. And then we took those words that the world defined us as and we burned them in the fireplace. First thing that God told me was, He said, "You're an anointed lion." I was like, "Bro, let's go." Bro, let's go. How many of you are anointed lions? Come, one. There's one. Hey, at least you're willing to stand up for it. You know what I'm saying? Anointed lion. Amen. So, I'm sorry. I got off track there. We're going to go ahead. Verse 14 says, "Yes, the body has different parts, not just one. If the foot says, 'I'm not a part of the body because I am not the hand,' that does not make it any less a part of the body. If the ear says, 'I'm not part of the body because I'm not the eye,' would that make it any less a part of the body?" And it keeps on going there and going there. And then it says in verse 22, it says, "In fact, some parts of the body that seem the weakest and least important are actually the most necessary." You know, the other day, I was, you know, down in Wicks, and my dad had me helping him with his lawnmower. Once again, you're going to have to tell me what to do, because I don't know how to do it. So anyway, we got to take the deck off, and now we're putting it back on after we fixed it. And I'm just thinking, you know what? This is one of those little flimsy decks. I can just give it a good little kick. It's going to go in place. It's a Kubota. They don't do that. I went, boom! I was like, it didn't hurt, though, right then. Ladies and gentlemen, just because it don't hurt now doesn't mean something's not wrong with it, okay? That was a spiritual statement as well. Anyway, so the next morning I wake up and I'm like, bro, my toe is felt broke. You know what I'm saying? I was like, bro, anybody else had a toe injury before? Anybody else like, man, these toes ain't no good for nothing, bro. They just look bad. They all gross and filthy and people don't like them. And I can't show them off at the beach like my wife can because she has beautiful feet. And I'm like, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, and so, but when you start to walk with a bad toe, it lets you know real quick I'm important. Amen? Amen? Any of y'all ever worked out before? Listen, I worked out this week. My legs. I'm bad. I don't know why I do it. I should just leave them alone. But I had trouble wiping this week. If you ain't never had trouble wiping, you ain't never worked out. Okay? Y'all trying to fake it in here. Come on, hey, we are honest, open, and transparent, okay? Come on. Whew. Tell you what, listen. Hey, it might seem like it's an unimportant part of the body, but it is, I promise. Okay? Listen. So many of us, though, we think we're an important part. We think that we're not important, but you are so important in the kingdom of God. Why? Because you are part of the body. And if you are part of the body, you have a job to disciple people in life-changing ministries. And let me just tell you, you might run a ministry and you don't even call it a ministry. You might be one of those people that's like bebopping into the first day of school, like, "What's up, guys? How are y'all doing?" That's not going to be me, by the way. What's up, guys? How's it going? Hey, are y'all ready to have a great year? Me too. Okay, yep, uh-huh. Yep, I know you are too. Yep. You know what I'm saying? That is a ministry. Being that upbeat all the time, I'm like, bro, kind of blows my mind. But some of y'all are running ministries that you don't call ministry because why? Because God puts somebody on your heart and you call them. You say, "Hey, how's it going, man? Ah, really? How can I help? How can I help? What can I do?" Guys, so many of you run ministries
and life-changing ones at that, and you disciple people, but we have to understand what it is, and we have to do it more often. We gotta live it. So let me just say this. I'm going to keep reading here. I'm going to read verse 27. It says, "All of you together are Christ's body, and each of you is a part of it." Each of you are a part of the body of Christ. You see, I said that, but I wanted you to let you know that the Bible says that. You are part of the body of Jesus Christ. You see, it starts by saying yes to God and salvation. Caitlin talked today about it being the day of salvation. I believe that today we need to answer the call. Okay? The call to be saved and then the call after salvation. The conversion part after the salvation as well. See, there's a lot of different people in here. Amen? So it says, saying yes to God and salvation every minute of every day, dying to the flesh and picking His will in every single decision that happens in that day. Then it ends by saying yes to Christ the calling that He has given you. Walking, working, and sacrificing your body to His body. I want to end by saying this. I saw this the other day. My old college basketball coach tweeted something the other day. I know. I can't believe I played either. But he tweeted something that really caught me off guard, and it's such a true statement, and I want to share it with you because it's very vital to what we're doing here. It's very vital to what you're doing here. It's very vital to your walk. It says, if you're not passionate about growing God's church, if you're not passionate about growing the kingdom, if you're not passionate about growing God's people, then you're not passionate about God.
That's right. Amen.
So we all need to say this today. If I'm not passionate about growing God's church, and I'm not passionate about discipling people, and I'm not passionate in being and leading a life-changing ministry, then I'm not passionate about God. Because it goes hand in hand. It's not separated. I can't be passionate about God and hate my wife. I can't be passionate about God and gossip about all these people. I can't be passionate about God and walk up to the door and see somebody and say, I hope they're not coming in here. They don't look the part. They don't act the part. I can't be passionate about God if I have that mindset. If I'm not passionate about growing God's church, God's people, God's kingdom, then I'm not passionate about God. Caitlin, what job will you do? What job will you do? Because you see, some of us have a big job to do. And me and Scotty have talked about it. And guess what? We got burned a couple years ago. Let's just be honest. We got burned a couple years ago. And it hurt for the last 2 years. But we have made the conscious decision through prayer and seeking Jesus to trust again. To trust again. Now, I'm going to tell you. I've had hard conversations with people. I'm not scared to lead you and have those difficult conversations. Okay? But we're ready to trust again as a church and as a people. And it's your job to follow through with the calling that Christ has given you. I will help you. You can start the music. I will help you. I will lead you through with Jesus Christ to grow you, to lead. But guess what? We're building a building, which is the first part of the vision, in order to fulfill the second part of the vision, which is bring heaven to earth. Bringing heaven to earth. If Jesus said it, I believe him in it. What job are you going to do? Are you going to stand up? Are you going to have the big job? Or is your personality a little held back and you're going to do the little job? I don't care which job you do, but everybody sitting in a seat today has a job. God's church isn't built with a pastor. God's church is built with his people. God's church is built by other sheep making more sheep. Because you are so passionate about what God is doing in your life that you're going to go tell the black sheep, this is what God's doing in me. And when that black sheep is changed, guess what happens? The white sheep in that family are like, what happened to the black one? He must have got a hold of some good. He got a hold of Jesus Christ. And so guess what that's going to do? That's going to multiply. But ladies and gentlemen, listen, I'm not trying to build a church. I'm trying to build the kingdom of Christ. That should be your focus as well. I don't care if you come to my church. I want to make an impact on you so that you go try church. And I'm not just talking about church. I'm talking about Jesus Christ. What job will you do today? God, I come to you and I praise you, Father. You are so good. Father, I pray for salvation today. I pray for conversion today. I pray for healing today. I pray for you to move in this place, Father. God, I pray for people to say yes to you and lay their life down on the altar as a living sacrifice, Father, and they never get back up because they are surrendered to you and what you have for them. And they answer the call, Father. They are not just saved, but they are called, and they answer that call of Jesus to grow the kingdom of Jesus. Father, may the enemy no longer confuse my mind with building a church. I want to build your kingdom. Praise you. For you are good. May we see a movement of the Holy Spirit in this place. In your son's name, amen. Please stand.